Bhagavatam. The first letter Bha, Swami said, stands for bhakti, devotion. Ga stands for jnana or wisdom. Va means vairagyam, which is detachment. Tha means the tattva of the fundamental principles. And mu, Bhagavatamu, Swami says, mu is bhakti, sorry, mukti or liberation. And he said, when you study the Bhagavatam, you will get all these five. And over the last 11 days, we have all basked in the wonderful stories from the Bhagavatam, so beautifully narrated by Sri Badri Narayanan. It has had such a lasting impact on all of us, young and old, powerful, engaging, witty, and has kept all of us in an euphoria. Now, for the last time during these 11 days, may we please invite Brother Badri yet again to enthrall our hearts and caress our souls with the stories of our dear Bhagavan and his devotees. Sai Ram.
Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om Shri Kanto Matalo Yasya Janani Sarva Mangala Janaka Shankaro Devaha Tambande Kunjarananam Ya Devi Stuyate Nityam Vibudhai Veda Parakaihi Same Vasata Jihva Gre Brahmarupa Saraswati Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwaraha, Guru Sakshat Parabrahma Tasmai Shri Gurave Nama. Yo Anta Pravishya Mama Vacham Imam Prasuptam Sanjeeva Yatta Kila Shakti Dharasva Dhamnam Anyam Chasta Charana Shravanatva Kadin Prananamo Bhagavate Purusha Yatubhyam Prakasha Madhyastita Chitsvarupam Varabhaye Sandhatatim Trinetram Sindhura Varnanchita Komalangi Mayamayim Tattvamayim Namami Krishnaya Vasudevaya Haraye Paramatmane Pranata Kleshanashaya Shri Govindaya Namo Namaha Krishnaya Vasudevaya Devaki Nandanaya Cha Nanda Gopa Kumaraya Shri Govindaya Namo Namaha Namo Brahmanya Devaya Go Brahmana Hitaya Cha Jagad Hitaya Krishnaya Shri Govindaya Namo Namaha Yasya Smaranamatrena Dvaita Vasana Pramuchyate Bodhatmakaya Namastasmai Bhagavate Shri Ramana Maharishe Hridakashe Sada Bhantam Shantam Anandarupinam Jnanabhanumaham Vande Sadgurum Shri Sathya Sayinam Sarvatra Govinda Nama Sankirtanam Haranam of Parvati Pataye Haranam. Sai Ram. as we sit here today, Bhagavan has blessed me with the great privilege of conducting the first spiritual discourse in the Sathya Yuga. So gracious, so compassionate that he has kept his discourse to later. But then, during one of the sessions, after one of the sessions, Bhagavan admitted something to me, which I would like to share with everybody. He said, "Yes, I am speaking, I am listening, and I am deriving ananda." And so if the last 10 days have brought any measure of ananda to everybody, it is purely and surely because it was Bhagavan who was speaking. This was only an instrument. Badri was not speaking. It was Swami that was speaking. Swami sent word yesterday. We were supposed to finish it yesterday. Swami sent word saying, shorten it because there are other programs and you can continue it tomorrow. In everything that Bhagavan does, there is meaning and value. Yesterday was Vijayadashami, the day of victory, and therefore it was appropriate that we saw Krishna's victory over Kamsa. Today, as the first day of Satya Yuga, it is also Friday, most appropriate to do Rukmini Kalyanam. So Bhagavan, in every little way, has planned everything out so beautifully. He doesn't explain it to us, it is up to us to understand the inner workings of everything that Swami does. Everything has got perfection in it, perfect meaning in it. It is only up to our hearts to understand that and revel and bask in that ananda. When Bhagavan went to Mathura, Swami alluded to this in the discourse. Bhagavan sent Uddhava with a letter addressed to the Gopikas. The Gopikas were in great sorrow. Their sorrow was not because they identified Bhagavan with only the body. They were very clear on that. In fact, they were the first ones to understand Krishna's divinity. But the sorrow, in their terms, was very simple. They said, "This body, O Krishna, is for you. This body, mind, etc. is only for you. If you are not there, then what is the use of this body, mind? That is all." It is not that they were unaware of his divinity. It is not that they were unaware of his omnipresence. It is just that they said, "Well, what is the use of this existence if it is not for you? There is nothing to be gained by having this existence. This continued existence is of no use to us if these eyes cannot look at that Krishna form." Why? Is Krishna only the form? No, but then they are not the body either. But if there is the body, if they had eyes, then they said the eyes are only to see Krishna. We don't need the eyes, but if the eyes have been given to us, it is only to see Krishna. If the ears have been given to us, it is only to listen to Krishna's flute. If these bodies have been given to us, it is only to render service to Krishna. In the absence of the physical Krishna, there is no need for the physical body also. They were not obsessed with their bodies. They were not obsessed with Krishna's physical body, but they were very clear, our connection is heart to heart. Then why body? Then why is this body there? That is all. In that agony, they were living their lives. Bhagavan also cannot be happy when his devotees are not happy. And so he called Uddhava one day and he said, "Uddhava, go and give them this letter." Uddhava said to Bhagavan, "Bhagavan, why don't you go and see them? Mathura is not very far away from Vrindavan. There is no hard and fast rule that you can't go. I will clear your diary." Because you see, Uddhava was Bhagavan's minister. He said, "I will clear all your appointments. I will give you a free day. You go. You go and enjoy. Take a weekend off. Go to Vrindavan. Spend the weekend in Vrindavan. Come back. What is there in this?" Krishna laughed and said, "Uddhava, don't you think I know that? If I go now, what will it do? It will give them 2 days of ananda and it will go back into that same sorrow once again. How many times can I keep going and coming?
I'm not even going to stay in this Mathura for very long. That being the case, what is the use of merely temporarily propping them up? No, no, I want a permanent solution to this. That is why I want you to go with this letter. Uddhava was not keen to go because Uddhava did not want to leave Krishna's presence. Krishna insisted that Uddhava should take this letter and go because Bhagavan also wanted Uddhava to know the extent of the bhakti, the prema of the Gopikas. Uddhava was an extraordinarily intelligent person. Uddhava Buddhisattamaha. Uddhava was chosen by Devaguru Brihaspati himself. Scholarship student he was. Brihaspati had his own university, it seems, and used to look around for good candidates. And when he found Uddhava, he said, I'll give you a scholarship, come and study with me. So Uddhava was trained by none other than Brihaspati himself. He was such an extraordinary intelligent person. He understood the omnipresence of Krishna, but at the same time, he thought, why should these Gopikas cry? What is there to cry about? Is not Bhagavan omnipresent? Bhagavan wanted to show that there was something greater than mere intellectual understanding. There was pure prema. And he wanted his dear friend, his beloved friend Uddhava also to taste that prema. And that is why Bhagavan gave the letter and sent him away. Uddhava came to Vrindavan. Uddhava was looking exactly like Krishna. Uddhava lived his life like that. He did not have a life of his own. Whatever Krishna wore and discarded, he wore those same clothes. The garland that Krishna wore and discarded, he would wear the same garland. The food that Krishna ate and left behind, that only Uddhava would eat. If Krishna did not leave anything behind, Uddhava would not eat that day. Therefore, Bhagavan had to necessarily leave something for Uddhava. The perfume that Bhagavan used and discarded, that was used by Uddhava in this way. Uddhava himself later on declares in the Ekadasha Skandam, he tells Bhagavan, Bhagavan, I have conquered your Maya. Very boldly he says, I have conquered your Maya. And the reason, the confidence he gets because he says, I have not had a life of my own, my life is you. Then how can I not have conquered my Maya? If I have lived my life for you and I have still not conquered your Maya, then what is the point of living for you? There must be something to it. And thus, he was very confident and he declares, Mayam Jaye Mahi, I have conquered your Maya. Such was Uddhava. When Uddhava went to Vrindavan, even as he got down from the chariot, it looked as though Bhagavan himself had come, but the Gopikas knew because their heart was very pure and true to Krishna. They would not be misguided by a lookalike. So they knew this was a very close friend of Krishna. Somebody very, very close to Krishna, because otherwise Krishna would not send just about anybody to Vrindavan. Vrindavan was Bhagavan's secret. Bhagavan would not call anybody and send them to Vrindavan. Only those whom he could trust with his very life he would send to Vrindavan, they knew that. Therefore, they knew Uddhava was a very, very close confidant, a friend of Krishna, a servant of Krishna. They went to him and in a moment of anger and pique, they said to him, no doubt you have come from Krishna. Krishna must have sent a letter to his parents. After all, they are the only people here that he will think about and care about. Others don't matter to him. Uddhava said, no, no, it is for you that I have come. Bhagavan has sent a letter for you all. Please read this letter. And he gave a missive to them. Several of the Gopikas said, what do we do with writing? We don't even know how to write. Why? Krishna did not know how to write. We heard he went to Sandipani Ashrama, learned how to write. Now he's sending a letter. What do we know about writing and reading? All we know is Krishna's flute. Has he sent a music for us? That we will understand. None of the Gopikas seemed to know how to read. One of the Gopikas had come from another village. She had married from another village and come into this village. She knew how to read and write. And so they all said, she knows to read, please give it to her. And that Gopika said, no, 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 please don't give Krishna's letter to me. Because thinking about Krishna, I am constantly crying. If I should hold the letter in my hands, then the tears that are flowing from my eyes will smudge all the lettering and nobody will be able to read it. Don't give it to me. Uddhava said, is there no one that can read? One other Gopika was able to read. So Uddhava said, in that case, please take this letter, this scroll, you read it. And she said, no, no, don't give it to me. My whole body is burning up in the fever of separation from Krishna. If I should touch this letter, it will catch fire and burst into flames and the letter will be lost. Therefore, I cannot touch this letter. In the end, Uddhava had to read the letter. And in the letter, Uddhava said to them, as written by Krishna, Krishna had said, my dear friends, I know that you are all deeply in sorrow over the fact that I have come away to Mathura. But it is not right for you to be sad in this manner. You can never be separated from me, nor can I ever be separated from you. We are not merely these bodies, we are the Atma. There is no need for us to feel this kind of sorrow. Remember the days that we spent together happily, remembering those days again and again, reliving those moments again and again, you will get rid of all your sorrow. Listen to what Uddhava has to say and go over your sorrow. This was the letter that Bhagavan had written and sent. The Gopikas made Uddhava read that letter again and again. Does Bhagavan remember us? Did Bhagavan say he remembered the days that he spent with us? Did Bhagavan remember the dance in the night? In this manner, they were thrilled that Bhagavan should have remembered them. Uddhava spent several months with the Gopikas. He had told Krishna he will come away immediately, but he spent several months with them. And he learnt the true extent of their bhakti, for the Gopikas saw nothing other than Krishna in all the things. Wherever they went, they saw Krishna. When they saw the mud upon the ground, they remembered Krishna eating it as a small child. They remembered Krishna's footprints upon that sand. When they looked at the river Yamuna, they were reminded of Krishna and his leelas in the Rasakrida in the Yamuna. When they saw the peacock, they were reminded of the peacock feather that he wore upon his head. When they saw the flowers, they were reminded of the garland that he wore upon himself. When they saw the cows, they were remembering how Krishna would move along with those cows. When they saw the trees, they were remembering how Krishna would climb the trees and play there. When they saw the snake, they remembered Kaliya and how he danced upon him. Every time they saw Govardhana, all they could see was Govardhana Giridhari. When they saw the blue sky, they were reminded of Krishna's complexion. When they saw anything yellow, they were reminded of Krishna's clothes. When they saw the butter, they were reminded of how Krishna would love the butter and eat the butter. In this manner, in every aspect, whatever little thing that they saw in their lives, they were immediately transported into a Krishna loka. Uddhava marveled at the depth of devotion that these people could have. Generally, devotees will gather here for such occasions, feel a great sense of thrill and euphoria. They will all go back to their respective hometowns. It will last for a few days. Then it will keep going down and down and down until ultimately they will not feel anything anymore and they have to come back again to recharge their batteries. That was not so with the Gopikas. Even though Krishna had gone away, the intensity with which they remembered him, the intensity with which they loved him had not diminished even a little bit. And this is not just now. 100 years later, they were able to meet Krishna in the Kurukshetra field. 100 years later, Krishna organized a great reunion and brought all the Gopikas, says the Bhagavatam. For 100 years, they kept the flame of Krishna Prema alive in their heart, just as it was when Krishna had been playing in their midst. To have a momentary feeling of bhakti is not bhakti. Sustaining is bhakti. Acharya Shankara, in Shivananda Lahari, when he describes bhakti, he says, to reach the lotus feet of Bhagavan and to stay there, tishtati sada, sa bhakti ritya vidiyate. It is not enough to just reach Bhagavan, but to stay, abide in Bhagavan is what is called bhakti. That is what is called prema. Otherwise, it is possible for everybody to love. Love is there in all of us. Momentarily, all of us will be moved. Momentarily, all of us will be captivated and all of us will love. What is there in that? If it cannot be sustained, then it does not deserve the appellation bhakti, says Acharya Shankara. The Gopikas were the epitome of that kind of bhakti, of that kind of prema. And on seeing that prema, on seeing that bhakti, with great reluctance, Uddhava left the place. The Gopikas had to tell him, please go back. Why are you staying here this long? Krishna will need you. You should be of assistance to Krishna. Go and serve Krishna. Go away from here. And they had to send him. And when he went, he said, he fell at the feet of the Gopikas. He took the dust of their feet and put it upon his head. And he said, Vande Nanda Vrajastrinam Padarenum Abhikshnashaha Yasam Harikatod Gitam Punati Bhuvanatrayam. I salute repeatedly the Gopikas. I take their dust of their feet and treasure it and put it upon my heads, because when the Gopikas sing Harikata, when they sing the glories of Hari, all the three worlds are purified. Everybody else is also singing Harinama Sankirtana. They are not even able to purify themselves because they are singing with such less intensity. But when the Gopikas chant the name of Hari, all the three worlds are getting purified. I salute them repeatedly. In this manner, Uddhava also learnt the prema of the Gopikas. The Gopikas also were reassured by the thought that Bhagavan was constantly thinking about them and was wishing that they would also be established in the high state of jnana. Srimad Bhagavatam says that after listening to the words of Uddhava, the Gopikas also were able to control that great agony, the great sorrow that was threatening them. Instead, they transmuted that also into ananda, and from then on, they remembered Krishna just as always, but with ananda instead of viraha tapa, instead of the pain of viraha. Bhagavan went to Dwaraka, established himself in Dwaraka. When Bhagavan was in Dwaraka, Bhagavan's divine marriage with Rukmini Devi took place. Bhishmaka was a king of Vidarbha Desha, and he had 5 sons and a daughter. The 5 sons were called Rukmi, Rukmaratha, Rukmabahu, Rukmakesha, Rukmamali, all alliterated. And the daughter was Rukmini, the smallest Ruk of them all. Ruk means gold. So all of them had the same appellation, Ruk, Ruk, Ruk. And she was the Rukmini. Ever since her childhood, Rukmini was devoted to Bhagavan. Many wandering minstrels used to go around. By this time, Bhagavan's glories had already began to spread. And many of these Bhagavatas would go around chanting the glories of Sri Krishna. Several of them would come to Bhishmaka's palace also, and there, sitting there, they would deliver several discourses on the leelas of Krishna. All the other boys would run away. Rukmini alone would sit there and listen to all of those Kalyana Gunas of Bhagavan, and in doing so, lost her heart over to Krishna. And then and there decided that when she should grow up and become of a marriageable age, the only person that she would marry would be Sri Krishna. This was her constant prayer. This is how she was living her life. In the due course of time, she did reach her marriageable age, about 8 years or so. In those days, they got married very early. Bhishmaka, the king, was considering suitable proposals for his daughter Rukmini. Rukmi, the eldest son, was also there, and he was consulting with him. And he said to him, "Rukmi, it is time for your sister Rukmini to get married, and I have got somebody in mind for her. Rukmi said, "Is that so? I also have somebody in mind. You tell me who you have in mind, and I will say who I have in mind for Rukmini." So then Bhishmaka said, I have in mind Krishna, Vasudeva, son of Vasudeva and Devaki, Dwarakadisha, Shri Krishna is who I have in mind. Immediately Rukmi got up and said, "Are you out of your mind? Have you become senile in your old age? Can't you think straight? How can we give our wonderful daughter Rukmini in marriage to a person like this Krishna? No, 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 I don't want Krishna. I have somebody else in mind." "Who do you have in mind, Rukmi?" Rukmi said, "I have in mind Shishupala." Shishupala, Chedi Raja, Shishupala. "You want to give Rukmini to Gopala? I want to give him to Shishupala." You see, Gopala means caretaker of cows, veterinary doctor. Shishupala means pediatric doctor. Shishu means infant. Shishupala, one who looks after infant. Real doctor, pediatric doctor, real doctor. Veterinary doctor is not even a real doctor. We can't give Rukmini away to such a person. Rukmini should only be given over to Shishupala. In this manner, he was abusing Krishna in various ways and was saying that Shishupala was the right choice. Shishupala, Kamsa, Jarasandha, Rukmi, they were all the same category of people. And Bhishmaka himself was afraid that if he opposed Rukmi too much, then Rukmi will not hesitate to throw him into the prison and crown himself as the king. He did not want that. Therefore, very reluctantly, he said, "All right, do as you wish. I don't want to have any part in this choice. You may give Rukmini in marriage over to Shishupala." Invitations were sent out. Jarasandha, Damagosha's son, Shishupala, were all informed about the impending marriage. Shishupala was very happy. He was going to get married to Rukmini. Rukmini looked like a statue of gold. Who would not want to be in association with her? So Shishupala was very, very happy. The news reached Rukmini and she was heartbroken. All her life she had pinned her hopes on marrying Krishna, and yet when it was Shishupala that her father had proposed to give her away or had planned to give her away, she was heartbroken. She did not know what to do. Just at that time, a Brahmana arrived there. He was one of the Brahmanas who would come and tell several of the stories of Krishna. His name was Sunanda. When this Brahmana Sunanda came there, Rukmini went and fell at his feet and she said to him, "Swami, you must somehow make my marriage possible only with Sri Krishna. I cannot marry Shishupala. I will give up my life. I will not live, but I will not marry Shishupala." The Brahmana also said, "Amma Rukmini, ever since I have seen you and seen your devotion to Krishna, it has been in my heart also that you are the right fit for him. Therefore, I suggest you do something. Send me a message. Send a message with me. I shall carry that message to Sri Krishna and give it to him. He will then do as he sees fit." Immediately, Rukmini sat down and wrote a beautiful letter to Krishna. She wrote that letter and gave it to the Brahmana and he said, "Somehow, hey Brahmana Devata, you must make this marriage happen." He took the letter and immediately set forth to Dwaraka. Bhagavan had an open door policy for Brahmanas in Dwaraka. When Brahmanas came, nobody can stop them at the gates. They were allowed to go wherever they pleased. That is how when Sudhama also comes, he could walk straight up onto the Antapura of Bhagavan and Rukmini itself. Brahmanas held a special position in Bhagavan's heart. Nobody, Bhagavan had given strict instructions to all the people that worked for him that nobody should stop a Brahmana anywhere. They can go wherever they want. So Sunanda also had the direct approach. He could go straight into Bhagavan's chambers and he sat there. Bhagavan welcomed him there and he said, "Come, O Brahmana, what is it that I can do for you?" He gave the letter to Bhagavan. "Bhagavan, I come from Vidarbha Desha. Rukmini, the princess of Vidarbha, has got this message for you." Bhagavan opened that message and gave it to the Brahmana and said, "You read it yourself." And the Brahmana read it out, Sri Rukmini Uvacha. Shrutva gunan bhuvana sundara shrinvatante nirvishyakarna vivaraihi haratongatapam rupam drisham drishimatam akilartalabham tvayachyuta vishati chittam apatrapam me. Beautiful letter from Rukmini Devi. She addresses Krishna as Bhuvana Sundara, the beauty of all the three worlds, the one who gives beauty to all the three worlds. She has never before seen Bhagavan, and so she says, "I have not seen you, but I have heard about your gunas." And simply listening to your gunas have entered into my ears and have formed a beautiful picture of you simply based on attributes. The form is one thing, but the form that is built of attributes is something that can never change. Even Bhagavan's form will change, but Bhagavan's gunas will never change. Bhagavan's kalyana gunas, his auspicious attributes will never change. And that form that is created above with his gunas can never change. This was the form that Rukmini Devi had been meditating upon all her life. And in that letter she said to Krishna, "Bhagavan, Shishupala has been proposed for me. I cannot bear to think about Shishupala. Vidya katva mukunda mahati kulashila rupa vidya vayodra vinadhama biratma tulyam dhirapatim kulavati navrani takalnya kale nrisumhara lokamano bhiramam." Rukmini tells Bhagavan, "Hey Narasimha," knowing what Bhagavan is, who Bhagavan is, reminding Bhagavan, she says, "Hey Narasimha, O Lord, who incarnated as Narasimha, I have dedicated myself only to you. You alone should come and marry me. On the other hand, Tanme Bhavan Kaluvratapati Rangajayam Atmarpitascha Bhavato Atra Vibho Videhi Mavirabhagam Abhimarshatu Chaidya Arad Goma Yuvandrakapater Bhalim Ambujaksha." She reminds Bhagavan, she says, "Bhagavan, hey Veera," she calls him Veera in Sanskrit literature. The only person who can be called Veera is Sri Rama. Every time the word Veera is mentioned, it automatically refers to Sri Rama. Therefore, she is referring to him as Sri Rama and she says, "Hey Ramachandra, hey Veera, I am the Veera Bhagam, the hero's portion. Let not a jackal like Shishupala come and touch me. That which is the lion's portion, only you should come and take me." In this, they say, she is reminding him, in the previous avatara, you let this fellow take me and go. Don't do it again. That is why she is using Veera, "Hey Ramachandra." In the previous avatara, the same Shishupala was the one who had come as Ravana. The same Rukmini Devi had come as Sita then, and the same Sri Krishna had come as Rama. At that time, she is saying, Bhagavane, you allowed me to be taken away by this Shishupala, this mere fox, when you are the lion, don't do it again. This time, I'm not going to put up with it. That is why she is referring here, it seems, she is saying, Ma Veerabhagam, I am the Veerabhagam, do not let me be taken away by Shishupala. Purteshta dattana yama vrata deva vipra guru varchanadivihi alam bhagavan pareshaha aradito yadi gadagraja etyapanim grinnatumena damagosha sutadayonye. If I have been true to you, if I have been worshipping Bhagavan all my life, if I have worshipped the Brahmanas, if I have been true, if I have kept to the Sathya and Dharma, then Bhagavan, you alone should take my hand, not Damagosha's son Shishupala. Shobhavinitvam ajitodvahane vidarbhana gupta sametya pratana patibhi paritaha nirmatya chaidya magadhendra balam prasakhya mam rakshasena vidinodvah viryajulkam. And I don't want to run away or anything. I want you to come in front of all the assembled armies. You should come, show your prowess, show your strength and take me by the hand through the rakshasa vidhana and take me and go. Several kinds of marriages are sanctioned in the Shastras. 8 kinds of marriages are there. One of those is called the Rakshasa Vidhana. In the previous avatara, in Ramayana, in Sundarakanda, we see Ravana coming there and telling Sita, Hey Sita, I have not committed any adharma. In our Rakshasa clan, it is allowed for us to forcibly carry away another woman and marry them. It is called the Rakshasa Vidhana. Sita laughs at that time and she says, You are talking about dharma without knowing dharma. I will teach you dharma. That is why in this avatara, she is telling Krishna, this fellow Ravana, who has come back as Shishupala, he did not know what the Rakshasa Vidhana was. He thought forcibly carrying away someone else's wife is Rakshasa Vidhana. The fool did not know, teach him at least now, Lord, what it means for Rakshasa Vidhana. When the woman is willing, then the man can come and take her away forcibly. That alone is called Rakshasa Vidhana, not otherwise, not forcibly taking her against her wishes. Therefore, teach him what the Rakshasa Vidhana is. That is why she is using these particular words, is the opinion of the wise commentators of the Bhagavatam. Antapurantaracharī manihatya bandhūn tvāmudvahe katam iti pravadāmi upāyam. Purve Durasti Makati Kuladeva Yatra Yasyam Bahir Navavaduhu Girijam Upeyat. Hey Bhagavan, if you are asking me how shall I come and take you away without causing any bloodshed, without causing any harm to all your relatives, then I will tell you the Upayam, the method for that also, the solution. The only day when the princess of Vidarbha Desha is allowed to come out in public is the day before her marriage, when she is allowed to go and worship Girija Devi in the temple. At that time you should come and take me and go. Yasyangri pankajarajasnapanam makhanto vanchanti umapatirivatma tamopahatyai yarhi ambujakshana labheya bhavat prasadam jahyam asun vratakrishan shatajanmabhisyat. If on the other hand, in spite of everything, Bhagavan, if you do not come, if you will not come tomorrow to rescue me, then I shall give up my life through vrata. I will fast and give up my life. I shall worship the Lord and give up my life. But never shall I marry anybody else other than you. I have devoted myself to you. I have dedicated myself to you. I belong to you. And I shall not be given away to anybody else. Even if it takes me 100 births, I will wait for you. But I shall not submit to anybody lesser than you. This was the letter. Bhagavan read the letter and laughed. And he said, Daruka! Bhagavan's chariot immediately brought Bhagavan's chariot. Bhagavan got onto the chariot, caught hold of the Brahmana and said, You also, and took him along with him. Overnight they reached the Vidarbha Desha. Balarama, looking at Krishna going away in a hurry, decided to gather all the army, the entire Yadava army, and they also followed. Bhagavan reached Vidarbha Desha. Hearing that Bhagavan had arrived, Bhishmaka went out as per protocol. He had to receive dignitaries, foreign dignitaries, and Krishna was certainly the dignitary of Dwaraka. Therefore, on the excuse of inviting a foreign dignitary to Rukmini's wedding, he went there. He took a very special drink called Madhuparka, which is only generally given to the bridegroom by the father-in-law to welcome him. In this manner, he took that and said, Bhagavan, I have a desire in my heart. You know what it is. You must fulfill it for me. Without openly telling what it is, he presented to Bhagavan. Bhagavan laughed and said, Yes, tathastu. So shall it be. Next day morning, the news had spread that Krishna had come. Shishupala called everybody, called Jarasandha, called Rukmi and told them all, listen, I'm trusting only you fellows. You all have to protect me. Make sure that Krishna does not take away Rukmini somehow or the other. He is capable of doing it. I'm depending on you fellows. Please protect me. They all said, don't worry. We will take care of you. All the armies had stationed themselves there or right on the alert. Everybody was right on the edge, waiting to prevent anything from happening. Rukmini Devi came out. She went to the temple of Girija, performed her worship there, prayed to the Devi. The Brahmana had already come and told her that Krishna had arrived in response to her prayers, so she was very happy. She prayed to Devi, thanked her for bringing the Lord to her. And she stepped out of the temple along with her maids. She was coming along, head bowed down. It was not appropriate for her to look up everywhere. Therefore, with her head bowed down, catching hold of her cloth, her sari, with her hands, lifting it up gently, she was walking. At the same time, she wanted to see Bhagavan. Her heart's desire was about to be fulfilled and she wanted to see Bhagavan. But how to look up and see Bhagavan? It was not appropriate for a girl to look up like that. And so what she did was, in the pretext of moving her hair from her face, she lifted up her bejeweled hand. She was wearing 5 rings on all the fingers and all the rings were connected to her bangles through gold chains. That was the bejeweled hands. With that, she slowly lifted up the locks of her hair and one straight look, the heart of the devotee knows the Lord. She did not look at anybody else. She straight looked at Bhagavan only to see Bhagavan looking at her. If you look to me, I look to you, says Swami. She looked to him and found him looking at her. The next instant, even as she was watching Bhagavan, Bhagavan said, Daruka. Immediately the chariot flew. In the speed of light, it flew there. It came around. Bhagavan bent down, lifted up Rukmini, put her upon his chariot and took her for a ride. Bhagavan gave her a literal lift. Generally, we say, please give me a lift. Bhagavan lifted her up and put her on the chariot. And in a flash of lightning, even before anybody could realize what was happening, from suddenly the chariot came. Bhagavan lifted up Rukmini and the chariot went away. And all the kings who had assembled there to stop this thing from happening, what were they all doing? They were all standing and watching. What a wonderful divine couple this is. Sakshat Mahalakshmi and Bhagavan together. How wonderful. How wonderful this pairing is. How wonderful is our good fortune to be able to look at this pairing. They were all watching and enjoying the divine entrancing beauty of Bhagavan and the divine mother. Jarasandha and Rukmi were the first ones to snap out of the trance. They said, hey, what is happening? Let us go follow this. Let us stop this from happening. So the entire army started to march forward only to be stopped by Balarama. Balarama defeated all of them single-handedly. They all had to come back. Rukmi alone did not want to give up and he went chasing. Meanwhile, Jarasandha came. Sushupala was sitting there all dressed up like the bridegroom. All ready for the wedding. Jarasandha entered in. And as soon as Jarasandha entered in, Sushupala looked up and said, is it time? Shall I go? Jarasandha, Bhagavatam is very beautiful. And the Jarasandha came and gave him a pat on the shoulder and said, Bho, bho, purusha shardhula. Oh, tiger among men. Oh, tiger among men, he said. Huh? Yes, what? I have something to tell you. Yes, Jarasandha, what? He said, Sukadukke same kritva labha labho jaya jaya. In this world, Sukha and Dukkha come, victory and defeat come. It is the mark of the brave to take everything with the same spirit. You see, 17 times I attacked Krishna and 17 times I was defeated. Only 18th time I was able to somehow capture Mathura. One should never give up. One should always keep our efforts going. So Sishupala said, that's all right. Why this Vedanta discourse on the eve of my wedding? Why are you telling me all this? Just to prepare you, Sishupala. Because let us go home now. Why go home? I have not yet been married. Marriage is over. But I am still here. Marriage is over. Krishna has married Rukmini. We can all go back home now. Sishupala trusted these men. That is what comes to us when we surrender ourselves to mere mortals. Bhagavan alone is Sarva Sharanyaha. He alone is worthy of surrendering to because he alone can rescue us. What is the use of surrendering to everybody else? Patigalu, Aivaru, Iddharenu. Purandarasa sings, what is the use of 5 husbands that Rukmini had? She appealed to everybody, but not one of them was able to come to her help. That is why later on, when Ashwatthama sends the Astra, Uttara, who has got Parikshit in her womb, she doesn't respond to anybody. She goes straight to Bhagavan and she falls at Bhagavan's feet and she says, I know nobody else other than you. Yatra mrityuhu parasparam. Apart from you, there is no abhayam, O Lord. Everybody is under the sentence of death. Who shall I surrender to but you? We should know who to surrender to. Shishupala surrendered to all his friends and he was abandoned. Those who surrender to Bhagavan are always protected. Bhagavan brought Rukmini back to Dwaraka, presented her to his parents, and there in front, in the presence of all the relatives, all the devas had assembled there. Wonderful occasion. It seemed as though Dwapara Yuga had suddenly given way to Satya Yuga. On that day, in that auspicious Kalyana Mantapa, with all the gods and the rishis present, even as it is today, Bhagavan, Lokapita, married Rukmini, the Lokamatha, Purusha and Prakriti, Shiva and Shakti, Narayana and Lakshmi came together in order to ensure the welfare of all this world. In this manner, Bhagavan's Rukmini Kalyanam was celebrated. Swami had said to complete this with Parikshit Moksham. The entire Bhagavatam was only narrated for the sake of Parikshit. 7 days only Parikshit had. And for 7 days, he listened to the Srimad Bhagavatam. In the Dwadasha Skanda, 12th Skanda, right at the end, Sri Shuka looks at Parikshit after having narrated all the stories, including Bhagavan's Leelas, Uddhava Geetha, and so on. He tells him, Tvam tu rajan marishyeti pashu buddhi imam jahi na jata prag abhuto adhya dehavatvam na nangshasi. Hey Rajan, O King Parikshit, as for you, after having listened to all this, give up this instant the association that you have with this body. Tvam tu Rajan marishyeti pashubuddhi imam jahi. Give up this pashubuddhi, this animalistic tendency that you are the body. Only animals think that they are the body, not human beings. Give up immediately this association, this dehabhimana. Give up the idea that you are going to die. Give up the idea that after dying you will be born again. None of these things appeal to you or are appropriate to you. Instead, listen to what I have to say. Keep this bhavam going within you. Aham brahma param dhama brahmaham paramam padam evam samikshanna atmanam atmanyadhaya nishkale. Constantly repeat to yourself, Aham Brahma Parandama, Brahmaham Paramam Padam. I am the Brahman, I am the Brahman. I am not this body, I am not this mind, I am not this jiva, I am the Brahman. I am the Brahman. Dashantam takshakam pade leli hanam vishananaihi nadrakshasi shariramcha vishvamcha pratagatmanaha. Constantly live in this Brahma Bhava. If you live in this Brahma Bhava, then you will not see Takshaka come and bite you. You will not see the body. You will not see this world. You will not see anything apart from yourself. Everything will appear as yourself. Takshaka will also be you. The body will also be you. The poison will also be you. The world will also be you. Sarvam khaluvidam Brahma. Everything here is the Brahman. Remain in that state. Shishuka gives this powerful message to Parikshit. Parikshit, in his turn, accepts it all, understands it, experiences it, and tells him, he says to Sri Shukha, Siddhosmi anugrihitosmi bhavata karunatmana shravito yachame sakshat anadi nidano harihi. Siddhosmi, I have accomplished what I have to accomplish. Anugrihitosmi, I have been blessed by you. Bhavata karunatmana. You with the, you yourself are compassion. Like Sri Krishna, you yourself are the embodiment of compassion. By your compassion, I have been blessed. By your compassion, I have been sanctified. By your compassion, I have attained the truth. Shravito yachame sakshat anadi nidano hari. You have told me, you have given to me Bhagavan himself. Bhagavan takshakebhyo mrityubhyo na bibhem yaham. Hey Bhagavan, I have no longer any fear about takshaka or of death. Pravishto brahma nirvanam. I am entering into brahma nirvana sthiti. Abhayam darshitam tvaya, you have shown me the highest state, you have shown me the truth of who I am, you have shown me that I am the Atma, I am not this body, therefore I have lost all fear. Ajnanancha nirastam me jnana vijnana nishthaya. On the other hand, ajnana has left me completely, I am established in jnana, in the wisdom and in the realization of the wisdom, vijnana. Bhavata darshitam kshemam paramam bhagavatah padam. You have shown me the highest state, you have given me equality with Bhagavan himself. I no longer consider myself as Parikshit, I am myself Krishna, I am myself the Atma, and in this manner Parikshit attained jnanam. Takshaka came and bit him, it is said, but Parikshit wasn't aware of it at all. He had already submerged his entire body, mind, his individuality into the highest, from that Vyashti to the Samashti to the Parameshti. He had already gone and merged himself into the highest truth. For the last 11 days, Bhagavan, you have given us all the wonderful opportunity to listen to you, because this Bhagavatam has been rendered only by you. 7 days, Parikshit heard this from Shishuka and attained the highest state. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa was able to produce so many jnanis as his disciples. We've all assembled here as Swami's children. It is not enough to keep constantly saying we are devotees, we are devotees, we are students, and so on. I remember once in Prasanthi, in a particular subject, lot of students had failed. Swami called the lecturer and took him to task and said, if so many students have failed, it is your fault, you have not taught properly. Bhagavan is our teacher. Bhagavan is our guru. If we don't pass, it reflects badly on him. And we cannot let that happen. We cannot claim to say we love him and at the same time, let him be appearing as the poor teacher. If we truly love him, then on this auspicious day when Sathya Yuga has taken birth, take a pledge. Each one of us should take a pledge. We will all become Atmajnanis. We will all become Brahmajnanis. We will all become masters. Enough of becoming students, masters, it is time for us to now become. Don't wait to enter into Premasai University as students, enter into Premasai University as teachers. That is the sankalpa we should all take. Yes, we should be with Premasai. Yes, we should serve him. But as teachers in his university, not students, how long will we keep learning? Chaduvulanni chaduvi chaduvi chavanga netiki chavule ni chaduvu chaduvavalayu. So many times Swami has sung this to us. Again and again, studying, studying, dying, studying, dying, studying, dying. What is the use of this? Chavule ni chaduvu chaduvavalayu. If we can't get this under Bhagavan as our guru, who are we able to go and get it under? Can we get this opportunity again? Will Bhagavan himself become the guru? It is not an opportunity for us to leave. Let us not live in the fond hope of a tomorrow when Premasai will come. Why? What is wrong with Satya Sai today? Why should we not get the truth right now, today, here in his presence? Then let us be with Premasai. Let jnanis surround Premasai. How wonderful that would be. Let him come and be surrounded by, like Dakshinamurti, let him be surrounded by rishis. Let us all of us become rishis like that. How long should we keep on playing this humble role? I am only a devotee, Swami. Sai did not come to make devotees. Sai came to make himself. Once in a discourse, Swami said, Ramakrishna produced one Vivekananda, but the Satya Sai will produce thousands and thousands of Satya Sais, he said, not Vivekanandas. Bhagavan wants to replicate himself in amongst all of us. It will not give Bhagavan joy in looking at us as mere devotees. Bhagavan will find joy when we are able to rise up to his level and declare to him, Swami, there is no difference between you and me. You have, by your extraordinary grace, by your extraordinary love, given me the same state as yourself. Swami coined a beautiful term never before heard in any of Vedanta. He said, Premadvaitam. Advaitam everybody has heard about, but Premadvaitam only Bhagavan coined it. He said, through love, see that all this is one. Everything is but the same Brahman. Everything is Swami. If we really love Swami, how can we see anything other than him? Should we not be so maddened in love like the Gopikas? The same Krishna has come, have the same Gopikas come? The same Rama has come, has the same Hanuman come? Should we let our Lord down? If Rama is Rama, then should we not be his Vanaras? If Sai is Krishna, then should we not be his Gopikas? Should we not be his Uddhava? Perhaps we can blame it on Kali Yuga until today, that because of the influence of Kali, we were not able to make any progress and so on. Swami has not given us any excuses from this moment onwards. There is no excuse whatsoever. We have to rise up and stand tall and let the world know that Sathya Sai is the producer of jnanis. Swami, having already offered everything to you, there is nothing more left to offer to you, Swami. Yet, even if I say I offer this Bhagavatam to you, it is ego, because you have said it. Who am I to offer anything to you? On behalf of everybody, we surrender to you, Swami. Guide us. As always, Sanathana Sarathi, your Partha Sarathi, one day, one Partha alone you guided. As Sanathana Sarathi, you are going to guide all of us. May we all understand the truth of who we are. May this so-called limited individuality go away from all of us. Let us understand that all of us are one and the same. Let no distinction exist between a person to another person. Let us all see each as, all of us, as simply aspects of your own divine love.
Ayodhya Maturamayam Kashi Kalchyavanti Dwaraka Puri Tulyatita Shri Putta Partishuddha Siddha Bukti Mukti Prabhava Chetral Taranga Sushobita Shobha Vilasa Goduli Dusarita Sundaranga Chitta Chora Adhyas Charya Agatana Gatana Samartya Nitya Vibhuti Leela Vibhuti Ubaya Vibhuti Nata Shri Ranganata Shri Venkatanata Shri Vaidyanata Shri Swaminata Shri Shalmukanata Shri Sai Nata Devadi Deva Deva Jaya Vijayi Bhava Puttaparthi Chakravarti Satchidananda Shri Dasharatha Rama Sita Rama Kodanda Rama Maruti Rama Sundara Rama Atma Rama Vattabhi Rama Shri Sai Rama Nityananda Premananda Brahmananda Paramananda Jnanananda Hrithayananda Atmananda Nitya Kalyana Jajwalya Nitya Shri Nitya Mangala Sarva Mangala Saubhagya Pradayaka Bhagavan Shri Sathya Sai Swarupa Swamitva Vatsalya Saushilya Saulabhya Ananta Kalyana Gunaganonga Maharnava Jaya Vijayi Bhava Sachitra Shai, Bhujagendra Shai, Nandanga Shai, Kamalanga Shai, Kshirabdi Shai, Vatapatra Shai, Shri Ranga Shai, Shri Sathya Sai, Swarupatma Lingot Bhavakara, Jyoti Lingot Bhavakara, Prema Lingot Bhavakara, Swarna Lingot Bhavakara, Ramya Lingot Bhavakara, Nada Lingot Bhavakara, Nabi Lingot Bhavakara, Shri Sai Lingeshwara, Shri Shiradishwara, Partishwara, Parameshwara, Jagadishwara, Maheshwara, Vishweshwara, Sarveshwara, Shri Sai Ishwara Akila Jagadadara Akila Jagat Swamin Asmat Swamin Acharanya Sharanya Shriman Narayana Akila Anda Koti Brahmanda Nayaka Satya Dharma Shanti Prema Imsavatara Satya Sai Swarupanetra Ananda Nityotsava Nitya Kalyana Sarva Mangalakara Sarva Bhuta Dayapara Sarva Bhauma Shri Sai Rama Satya Sai Rama Jaya Vijayi Bhava Jaya Vijayi Bhava Jaya Vijayi Bhava.
Mangalam Gurudevaya Mangalam Swaswarupine Mangalam Veda Vedyaya Mangalam Jnanadayine Mangalam Prema Rupaya Mangalam Shantidayine Mangalam Pujya Padaya Mangalam Shri Sathya Saini.